Hachette Audio presents Hokuloa Road, written by Elizabeth Hand, read by Kaleo Griffith. For Christabel Munson, with love and gratitude. Fear falls upon me on the mountaintop. Fear of the passing night. Fear of the night approaching. Dread of the place of offering and the narrow trail. Dread of the receding night. Awe of the night approaching. Awe of the dog child of the night creeping away. A dog child of the night creeping hither. From the Kumulipo, a Hawaiian creation chant. Translated by Martha Beckwith. It's so still. It's the quietest place on earth. You'll see for yourself. It's so beautiful. There's no one here. We're here. From Stalker, Andrei Tarkovsky. Chapter 1. Late one July morning, Grady's older brother Donnie texted him a screenshot of the ad for the caretaker job. Caretaker wanted: Hawaii. Independent and resourceful. Valid driver's license required. Carpentry skills a plus. Housing provided. Salary TBD. FireManta@island.net. Grady laughed. WTF? That Craigslist? Yeah, I'm a serious dude, Donnie replied. Email him. Instead, Grady called his brother. It rolled over into voicemail, which meant Donnie was probably trying to find a place to talk in private. He was 4 years older and lived in a halfway house not far from Portland, Maine, a few hours south of where Grady was on the mid-coast. A minute later, Donnie rang back.
Where'd you see that job listing?
Grady asked, voice low so he wouldn't wake their mother, who worked the hospital night shift as an LPN.
Just now, waiting room.
Donnie was midway through 2 years probation for fentanyl possession and had to take a weekly piss test.
I'm fucking serious. One of us should live in Hawaii, and you need to get out of mom's house. And shit, I gotta go.
The call ended. Grady shoved the phone into his pocket and walked out onto the back deck. His brother could be a major pain in the ass, but he had a point. Grady had been living with their mother since early April, just weeks after the lockdown, almost 3 months now. Their father was long gone. He'd killed himself when Grady was 5. The suicide was like a black drain they'd been circling ever since, though only Donnie got sucked down it. Before the pandemic hit, Grady had worked as a Finnish carpenter, most recently on a long-term gig for a couple of masshole plastic surgeons from Marblehead, husband and wife building their dream home on Sennebec Pond. Quartz kitchen countertops, a Japanese toilet with a heated seat that had its own temperature control. Who needed that shit? The job ended abruptly when the wife got COVID. Grady and the other crew had to isolate for 2 weeks. Grady definitely felt bad about that. They all needed the work. One guy had just bought a new truck. Another had twins on the way. No one got sick, but by the time quarantine ended, all the other building sites had shut down too. As an independent worker, Grady could collect unemployment. But after his application was bounced twice for no frigging reason, he gave up. His stimulus check went to back rent and 2 overdue truck payments. So he moved back home. Now it was July, and there was no work other than side jobs. Helping his friend Zeke load his delivery truck with firewood, or taking down trees decimated by venomous brown-tail moth caterpillars, clearing brush from the Mi'kmaq campground so that rich COVID refugees from Boston and New York could park their RVs and go hiking in the state park while they pretended to quarantine. Grady scrutinized the screenshot again. Caretaker wanted Hawaii. The only person he knew who'd ever been to Hawaii was a heating contractor in Rockland. He'd taken his wife and two young kids and lived on one of the Hawaiian islands for a year.
"The kids went barefoot the whole time,"
he told Grady after he returned.
"Walked to school barefoot, ate coconuts from our backyard. Me and Lisa surfed every day. It was friggin' heaven."
Grady couldn't remember the last time he'd walked barefoot anywhere except indoors. There were no sand beaches in this part of Maine, and the grass was filled with ticks. What would it be like to live someplace he wouldn't have to dig his truck out of a foot of snow, or ice, or mud, for half the year? He didn't know anyone in Hawaii, but then he'd hardly seen anyone in Maine since the pandemic began. Last time he'd run into his ex-girlfriend Rachel was 6 months ago. She'd been accepted into the PhD program in archaeology at Boston University. And, oh yeah, she'd gotten married. After that, he dated a girl he met on Bumble. But they'd had nothing in common except the fact they were 28 and single and lived within 20 miles of Rockland. Maine was great, if you had money and a partner, but otherwise it was lonely as hell. He sure as shit wasn't going to find money or a girlfriend during a pandemic. What the fuck? He had nothing to lose. He went to his childhood bedroom and opened his laptop, checked the screenshot again, and emailed Fire Manta. Chapter 2. The following afternoon, he'd just cracked a PBR and logged into World of Warcraft when an email alert flickered in the corner of his laptop screen.
"Hi, Grady. Is there a time we could talk this evening? Also, please send a copy of your resume. Best regards, Wes Minton." Fuck me.
Grady reread the message. Did he even have a resume? He logged out of WoW, grabbed another beer, and made a list of the carpentry jobs he'd worked on for the last 8 years. He found a resume template online and went to the White Mountains Community College website. "We're training New England's future outdoor leaders." He'd finished only 2 years at WMCC before he failed his wilderness solo and his money ran out. But maybe this guy wouldn't bother to check. He cut and pasted info from the site. Studied outdoor recreation and tourism at Foremost College, skills in sea kayaking, wilderness medicine, mountaineering, scuba diving, rock climbing. He'd never actually gone scuba diving, but figured that might be useful in Hawaii. He could always learn. He sat for a minute, then added certified EMT, which was true. He'd taken EMT classes after he dropped out of WMCC, though he'd only briefly worked as a first responder when he was 22. The local ambulance company had paid for his classes, paid for his textbooks, and offered him a job once he'd completed his training. He'd started a bit nervous, though not much. While the sight of blood bothered him, it didn't make him pass out. Same with protruding bones. He practiced box breathing and other ways of staying calm under pressure, and always felt jacked from adrenaline as soon as he stepped into the ambulance. He successfully performed CPR a few times, tended to some rollover accidents. He felt pretty confident that he'd at last found a job he could, if not excel at least perform without fucking up. That had ended when he got the call involving Kayla McIntosh. He saved his document and got another beer. He hated this kind of stuff. Hated thinking about Kayla. He was a terrible liar, unlike Donnie, though maybe Donnie wasn't so great either, since he always seemed to get caught. But lying came naturally to his brother, whereas it always made Grady anxious, even stupid white lies, like this resume, which looked decent, though it would be easy for someone to make a call to WMCC and learn that he'd never graduated, and probably his EMT certification had expired. But what the hell? He sent the resume to Wes Minton, logged back into WoW, and played for a couple hours. Around midnight, he received a new message from Fire Manta.
"Hi, Grady. Are you free to talk now?"
"Wes." Cursing, Grady pushed the line of empty beer cans into a wastebasket. He shouldn't have finished the half rack. What time was it in Hawaii? He went into the bathroom and hurriedly washed his face, slicking back his damp hair. He'd shaved this morning, so he didn't look too derelict. He returned to his room and replied, "I can talk now." Within seconds, an email with a Zoom link appeared. When Grady clicked on it, a dazzle of light and color filled the screen. Green, yellow, red, blue, orange, with a dark blur in the center.
"Grady! Good to meet you."
Grady blinked. The colors were palm trees, gigantic ferns, a trailing vine that looked like a burning pink fuse. In the middle of it all was an older white man's face, tanned and ruggedly youthful, though his dark shaggy hair was mostly gray.
"Hi."
Grady adjusted the light on his desk.
Yeah, nice to meet you.
What time is it there?
Almost 1 a.m.
Oof. Minton winced.
Sorry about that. Thanks for taking the time. I'm Wesley Minton.
Wes.
Okay if we go over a couple things?
Wes leaned forward, his face blotting out the brilliant garden.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.